In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord.
Amen.
I said I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord.
Thank you.
we may receive eternal salvation. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector,
James, the son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus, Simon the Cananean, and Judas Iscariot, who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus set out, instructing them, "Go nowhere among the Gentiles and enter no town of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel, and proclaim as you go, saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse lepers, cast out demons. You receive without pay, give without pay." This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, Lord.
I believe in God, and all of the nation,
and the Lord of the earth, and in Jesus Christ, the only Son of our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Son of the Holy Spirit. Grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. In these many weeks after Pentecost, this is the time of the church when we learn how Christ builds his church up. In this summer, we're going to look deeper into what are called the hard sayings of Jesus. Some of them only require some explanation, and others we actually know pretty well. And some others, those are the ones that once you understand them, you realize that they're even harder than you first thought. We pray that the Holy Spirit would open our hearts and minds to better understand the story of our salvation in Christ Jesus and how to walk together as he would have us walk. Once when Jesus had said a particularly difficult thing, Scripture tells us that many of his disciples turned back and no longer walked. Lord Jesus, send us your Spirit that we may not turn away in fear and frustration, but better learn how to walk together as one body, even as you are our head. Amen. Between Jesus' preaching of the parable of the sower and his explanation in private to his disciples are a couple of verses that we normally don't pay much attention to, because getting to the bottom about what the parable means took most of our focus. And it is a much-loved parable, so we don't think anything about it. Today we're going to focus on those couple of verses which are frequently overlooked proclamation. Jesus said to the crowd, "He who has ears to hear, let him hear." And when he was alone, those around him with the 12 asked him about the parables. And he said to them, "To you has been given the secret," in some translations the words "mystery," "of the kingdom of God. But for those outside, everything is in parables, so that they may indeed see but not perceive, and may indeed hear but not understand, lest they should turn and be forgiven." And he said to them, "Do you not understand this parable? How then will you understand all the parables?" So what is Jesus trying to tell us there? Jesus is explaining to us that current events develop very old promises. That's what that word mystery refers to. Modern English, mystery refers to something that we don't know the answer to, some secret that we're not privy to. But in the Bible, it means either a new revelation of God or an interpretation of an existing one. Jesus' earthly life and mission is this latter kind of mystery, in which many hundreds of Old Testament prophecies are revealed and come to fruition. If we hear only that there is some secret we need to uncover, but have failed to understand, then the Bible is an opaque mystery indeed. But when we read Scripture in light of Jesus' words and deeds, then we walk in the revelation of the kingdom of God for all believers. The problem of listening to Jesus' teaching in parables is not his obscuring the gospel with a hard-to-understand illustration. Only pastors are ever guilty. The problem of not seeing and not perceiving or hearing and not It's not that the 12 and those closest to Jesus are somehow more worthy or more holy to obtain the secret of the kingdom of God. The mystery is revealed to everyone. Everyone who encountered Jesus during his ministry or witnessed his passion, crucifixion, and his post-resurrection appearances. It's shown to each one of us. It is what we do or do not do with it that is the cause of the obfuscation that Jesus is talking about. Rejoice in the fact that each of you has been given the key which unlocks the mystery of the kingdom of God. You have the solution to all of life's problems. Don't you? Do I? That can't be all there is to it, is there? That is the situation we find ourselves in modern life, especially in the world we find out there in the past 2 or 3 months. Understanding gives way to more questions, chaos, anxiety. Anxiety that if we are not part of the solutions, then we must be part of the problem because we're still breathing. I know how to get to heaven, but that isn't helping me understand what's happening in Seattle or Washington, D.C., or Mentor, or Madison, or Thompson. Why does simply walking outside or listening to the news suddenly become such a mystery to us? Why can't we make sense of it? Why do both sides of every issue claim that God is on their side? Jesus said to the father of a boy who was possessed by a demon, "All things are possible for the one who believes." And the father immediately said back to Jesus, "Lord, I believe. Help my unbelief." And right there is the problem you're facing today. Right there is the reason why the world is so confusing and so seemingly contradictory. It seems so godless, so shrouded in what we perceive as an impenetrable cloak of mystery. Jesus said in this parable that the sower sows the word, and these are the ones along the path where the word is sown. And when they hear, Satan immediately comes and takes the word away, that which was sown in them. Once again, Satan is at work, yet we insist on doing his dirty work for him. So how do you respond to the Bible? It's easier for small children. They don't have any preconceived notions or years of challenging life experience to bring to the table, which clouds their discernment. They simply consider the source, God Almighty, and trust in faith. We're the ones that are letting our expectations of God and our attitude toward our neighbor to color our reception of the word. We allow the world to inform us how we use God's word in our lives rather than the other way around. Is the word list of demands that when you don't meet them, you feel terrible about it? Is it an encyclopedia of sound bites where you pluck the one to use as a nugget to further your opinion in judgment of others? Is it a textbook that you read and dismiss all the hard sayings because you don't understand them? Or perhaps you know them all too well, and you don't care for the image that paints in the mirror that becomes far too clear. We're each of us sitting with one foot planted firmly in Jesus' inner circle, and the other one is planted firmly with that word on the outside. Jesus understands our simple distrust and our simple misuse of his word. Those two are sins for which he died on the cross. Interestingly, Jesus uses the image of seeds for the word of God going out into the world. Seeds are buried in the ground and they die to provide new life. Just as the word kills your sinful nature and raises you anew with Christ's resurrection for you. Sometimes that word doesn't seem relevant to the life that sprawls as broadly and complexly as our modern times. Other times it may not seem necessary. But as a seed sown, the word always contains life. Even when it convicts us, even when it cuts us down like a noxious weed. The complex issues of our society which have been coming to the head ahead of the past couple of weeks may seem like situations that those simple first century Christians just wouldn't have had a clue about. And perhaps not. But 2,000 years ago, or yesterday, or tomorrow, the message of the word remains constant. God's approach for our life is revealed. And our misguided attempt to force his will to follow our desires are revealed as follows. Christ died so that you may have life eternal, as well as a meaningful life here in time. He lived and died and rose again to pay the price for our lives not being lived perfectly. And Jesus reveals in his parables that our lives should revolve around him and what he has done for the life of the world, not what we wish the world would look like, according to the gospel. King Solomon wrote, "One gives freely, yet grows all the richer. Another withholds what he should give, and only suffers want. Whoever brings blessing will be enriched, and the one who waters will himself be watered." God spread his word everywhere, from the most severe growing conditions to the most fertile. He didn't focus his effort on one group or another. God is not selective in whom he chooses for his kingdom. God's method is generous in the extreme. And that is probably the greatest mystery of all. The most paradoxical thing for us to comprehend. God chose you, and he chose me despite our unworthiness, despite our frequent disdain for his life-giving word. And that word does indeed give life freely. Despite the differences between us in that kingdom of the left, that earthly secular kingdom, the injustices we see, the perceived attacks on our freedoms, both real and imagined, in the middle of all of that turmoil, one thing remains constant. The word is for everyone. The kingdom belongs to all who repent and believe. And that should not be any profound mystery. And it should come as no surprise to us that that message is to be shared with friend and foe alike. Lord God, we ask that you remove the scales from our eyes, that we may see and believe, hear and understand, that Christ died and rose for all mankind. In the name of Jesus, amen. May the peace which passes understanding guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen.
Serve the Lord honorably and in accord with his word.
We pray for the poor and hungry, the homeless, the unemployed, and the oppressed, that the Lord grant them mercy, and that we may help to relieve their suffering and want. We pray for the sick, that the Lord would grant them healing, for the wounded in spirit, that the Lord would make them whole, and for the grieving, that the Lord would comfort them, especially all afflicted by the unknown pandemic and its effects. And we especially pray for Beth Brown, who is mourning the death of her father. And we pray for all those who are now named to be our God. We pray for the dying that they may have peace at the last, and for our grateful remembrance of all those who have died in Christ, that in the fullness of time, the Lord may bring us with them to his everlasting presence, for sin and death will trouble us no more. Lord, in your mercy. All these things and whatever else you know we need, we pray to you grant us, Father, for the sake of our Savior Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Hear us now as we pray in his name and ask his promise.